بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن كثيرا من الأحبار ويصدون عن سبيل الله والذين يكنزون الذهب والفضة ولا ينفقونها في سبيل الله فبشرهم بعذاب أليم. يوم يحمى عليها في نار جهنم فتكوى بها فذوقوا ما كنتم تكنزون. صدق الله العظيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I have a poem to present entitled Our Pride and Joy. Can one's heart change in a week? It seems impossible to many. A gift Allah bestowed upon our parents, our brethren, these organizations. A week to learn not only our deen, but social life and academic excellence. Still seems impossible? A reason we rise, a reason we live. Allah, tell me now that it's impossible, and I shall tell you for whom we work for. Allah, nothing is impossible. We are the future leaders of this country. Worry no more, for they have trained us for the task ahead. Have no fear, for we have Allah by our side. We are the parents of tomorrow. Worry no more, for our children shall benefit from the fruits of these organizations. Our pride and joy. They have won over our hearts, gained our love and trust within the speed of light. It seems miraculous, but leave it to them to prove you wrong. Thank you all.
To every human being. And I told my good friend, Mr. Jah, that the topics you have given me, that would actually take me days to present on. So that makes my task difficult because I'll have to leave here and go to attend to my official functions in the next 45 minutes. But I'll try to be as brief and concise as possible. And I'll leave about 10 minutes for questions. Now I'm going to cast my presentation within the framework of some statements from the Holy Quran, because I believe that whatever issues we deal with, whatever problems we want to solve, and now you have to listen to me. That's one of the things about me. Ladies, you have to listen to me. Hello, Mr. Chairman. Wherever I go to deliver speeches, I insist that people listen to me. Because in other jurisdictions, I would be paid in thousands of dollars to make speeches. And that's going to start very... This is actually one of the few free speeches I'm going to do in this country. So I insist. Excuse me if this sounds rude, but I insist that you listen to me because my time is valuable and the subject happens to be time management. Now, I was saying I'm going to cast my presentation within the framework of statements from the Quran because I believe that all our problems have their solutions in the Quran, and whatever goals we want to attain have the tools to their attainment in the Holy Quran, the greatest book ever revealed and the greatest miracle ever revealed in the history of the world. Now I'm saying this because in the Quran itself, Allah tells our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khayra qalqillahi kullihi, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ لَا تَمُدَّنَّكَ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَاهُمْ بِهِ. Allah tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most beloved of his creation, now we have revealed unto you seven of the oft-repeated verses and the great Quran. So do not stretch your eyes in covetousness towards other things that have bestowed on people. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking to his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I hope you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when I mention his name. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. Now here is the one command that Allah gives us, that He Himself obliges Himself to abide by. All your ibadat, that's the only thing that you do, and Allah Himself does it. So as Muslims, wherever we hear the name of Muhammad, okay, now you got it. My lecture is finished. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I have given you the Quran, so do not look at anything else. So that means that the Quran is sufficient for us, so we need not look further. And that is why I am going to base my presentation on the Quran. And this book that unfortunately sometimes we take for granted has all our solutions. But as the English saying goes, familiarity breeds contempt. You know, we are born, and the first thing perhaps we see, among the first things we see, is the Quran. It's recited around us from our naming ceremony to every other single event that we have the Quran. So it's so close to us, we sometimes take it for granted. But it's something that we need to be very attentive to, because it is the greatest gift that Allah has given us as Muslims. Now in that same Quran, in Surah Yusuf, verse 111, Allah tells us subhanahu wa ta'ala, مَا كَانَ حَدِيثًا يُفْتَرَى وَلَكِنْ تَصْدِيقَ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَتَفْصِيلَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةً لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. He says this Quran is not a new thing. It's not a narration that's invented, but it is a confirmation of what was before it. What was before it? It was the Torah, it was the Bible, it was the Zabur, all of the other books that Allah has sent to the other great prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us this Quran is a confirmation of that, and it is also a guidance and a blessing to those who believe. Now, if you have something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is calling a guidance, where else do you have to look for guidance? And this is why we have problems as Muslims, because we are looking for guidance from places where we are not supposed to look for guidance. In the same book, at the very beginning, he tells us, Alif Lam Mim, Dhalika al-Kitab la Rayba Fih. What does he add there? Hudan lil muttaqin. What's that? What does that mean in English? Guidance. So why are we looking for guidance in places different from the Quran, when Allah himself tells us this is guidance? But you know, okay. Yus, I hope if I stand, I will not affect your audio. It's okay. All right, he's our caravan cameraman. I hope you recognize him. That DRTS caravan. He was the man on top of the bus. And he doesn't want to be famous, but I want to make him famous. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the Quran is what? Guidance, right? But guidance for what? Can I have volunteers here, one or two? What does the Quran guide us to? To the straight path. What is the straight path? What? To paradise. Okay, what else? Sorry? I don't understand. You speaking Sarabuli? It's a difficult language, you know. Yes? Has he bestowed his favor on you? What's the answer? Now, this is guidance. But I think, just like the first answer I said, this is guidance towards paradise. And this is where the problem comes sometimes. When we think of guidance, Most of the time we are not thinking of the here and now. It's about going to heaven, right? Which is right, definitely, because that's the ultimate destination. But that Allah himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, who taught us this in the Quran, that the Quran is guidance, he's telling us also, he taught us a prayer. He said, Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati. So why are we sometimes restricting this guidance to wa fil akhirati, when in the beginning, the first part of the prayer even said fi dunya? Because I believe if you get it here right, you will get it right in the hereafter. And if you get it here wrong, you will get it in the hereafter wrong. So we cannot restrict the Quran to matters of ritual worship alone. The Quran is supposed to guide us not only in the mosque, but also in our houses, in our offices, even on the football field. It's supposed to guide us. Because it's a complete, total guidance, a light for us wherever we are. So we need to have a fresher perspective towards this book, such that even if you are studying for that chemistry exam, the Quran should be your source of guide. Even if you are reading that novel, the Quran is supposed to be that flashlight that's supposed to guide you. And it's supposed to be, he said, wahudan wa rahmatan. What is rahma? It's about sending us to hellfire, right? Because we have a problem with some of these Sarahule preachers, not the Bali Bukas, the Sarahules, whose preaching is all about taking people to hellfire. Now, this is a book of mercy. And the Prophet alayhi salam, who brought it to us, is a prophet of mercy. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلْنَاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. This prophet and this book is a blessing and a guidance for the entire human race. And we cannot deprive anybody of that rahmah. So we need to be careful when we approach this book, when we leave this deen, to know that God is not an angry old Kianka man sitting up there with a big stick looking for the slightest mistake to destroy you. No, he's not. He's a Lord of mercy. And that's why in every surah in the Quran, it starts with what? Bismillahir Nar. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. He's a Lord of mercy. So we cannot use this book and this deen to depress people in this world and to make people to live in fear. Naam. Bashiran wa nadhira is to give us God's tidings and warn us also. Because if you don't warn these Sarahulis, they will look for money anyhow. They will not obey any rules. But yes, the Quran is to warn us against fire, but it is also to give us glad tidings. So we have to know that this book that Allah brought us to warn us against the fire is even giving us more glad tidings than more bad warnings. And that's why Allah himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, tells us that we should not lose hope. We should not lose hope. La taqnadu min rahmatillah. Inna allaha yaghfiru dhunuba jami'a. This is a Lord of mercy. This is a religion of mercy. This is a religion of peace. This is a religion of hope. This is a religion that should have a role in everything that we do in our lives, and not just to make us live in fear. So we have to look at this book as a source of rahmah, as a source of huda. And that's why he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, tells us in the same Quran, Taha ma anzalna ilayka al-Qur'ana li tashqa illa tadhkiratan liman yahsha tanzilan. Looks like the boys are doing better than the Quran. Mr. Jah, you need to do something with your girls. Or maybe they are shy. Allah said he did not reveal this Quran for to make us distressed. No, it's not. It's a guidance. It's a source of glad tidings. It only becomes the other one when you deviate from that path. So that is why I'm going to approach this lecture on time management and self-esteem within the framework of the Quran and nothing else. And I can tell you there is not a better motivational speaker an author in this country than me, with all due humility. I've read all the books, from the Bible to the Bhagavad Gita to Napoleon Hill to Tony Robbins to Les Brown, you name the motivational speaker. Those people specialize in these things. I've read all their books, and nobody can give you anything better than what the Quran is giving you. Tanzilun min Rabbil Alameen. He's the one who created knowledge. So here is the tool for us. And I am not even going to talk about even 1/100. That's 1/10, right? For those of you who are Sarahulis. 1/100 is what? 1/100th. Right? I'm not going to quote you a full verse here. Just a few phrases, and we'll take care of this and go home. That's one of the shortest surahs in the Quran. Allah starts with an oath, and the oath has reference to time. Which surah is that? Surah Asr. And what does Allah say there? He says, "Wal Asr, innal insana lafi khusr." And he stops there. Huh? The surah is over. Why is it not over? Because Allah is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. If he stopped there, we'll all go to hellfire. Where does he go next? Illa alladhina amanu. And he did not stop there. Did he stop there? If he stopped there, we'll all be preachers for the rest of our lives and we'll have no business to even earn our living. But he goes further to say what? Wa amilu salihat. We have to walk. I don't care how pious you are, how dedicated you are, you have to walk to earn a living. Because Allah has ordained that we have to do that. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam did his work. He was the busiest guy in terms of tilawat, in terms of tahajjud, in terms of zikr, but he also walked to earn his decent living. Now let's just stop at Al-Asr. Allah is swearing by time. Why? Why does Allah swear by time? What's the rationale behind Allah taking oaths in the Quran? Wal-Asr, Wal-Fajr, Wal-Layl. Why? Yes. It shows it's important. Are you a Badimunga? Oh, you are a Fuller. Okay, you are very close together. Congratulations. Now, Allah takes these oaths to show of the importance of these things. So time is what? Important, right? And if it is important, we have to manage it. Just like we manage what? Natural resources, because natural resources are useless, right? Because they are important. And time, as far as I'm concerned, there's nothing more important than time. And that's why one of my mentees, I will have young people around me. One of my mentees once told me, "Sabally, I've realized one thing about you. The greatest crime that anybody can commit against you is to waste your time." And he's right. You can waste my $10,000, I'm okay with, but if you mess up with my time, you get to me. And that's why I'm very impolite when I come to these gatherings and people are trying to talk when I'm trying to make my speech, because you're wasting my time. One of my mentors, Benjamin Franklin, he says, if you would value your life, then take care of your time, because that is the stuff that life is made of. When we measure our life, how do we measure it in? In gold and diamonds and dollars and euros? How do you measure life? In years, right? That is time. So what is life made of? It's time. So if you are wasting your time, you are wasting your life. And this one is for the boys. You use that time, huh? That time. What do you say? You say you kill time, right? Next time you mention that phrase again, just realize you are killing yourself. Because time is what your life is made of. So let's move away from this business of killing time to what? To investing time. It's two things. You can use it for good or for bad. You can go PS the whole of the day. You can go play football and PS the whole of the summer. Or come to a summer youth camp and do a spiritual retreat. Gain some knowledge. Gain some spiritual inspiration. The time you are spending here is time invested. Now, I'm not saying you should spend all your holiday here. And if Mr. Jai is asking you that, tell him I said no. After a couple of weeks, go back home and enjoy. No, it's part of life. Enjoy legitimate enjoyment, mind you. But you can't spend all your summer holiday in play akara and ebe and nawetan and what else do you do? Weary, weary, right? What else do you use your time on? Give Huda TV some 5 minutes. If you are patient enough to watch my TV, do something on Iqra with Abu Bakr Dawo. Sometimes he invites some smart young people. Because our problem is, I think we have too many old preachers. We need to allow young people to share the podium also. So we need to use this time and invest it rather than what? Kill it. Let's stop killing time, because we are killing ourselves. Now, in this part of the world, There is no limitation to waste, to kill time and to waste your time. Wallahi, I cannot even start to make a sermons about that. Now, how do we waste our time? You got up, you are going to the halaqa, which is a word I only hear from the sisters, not the brothers. Or you're going to do your studies, and a friend comes, boy, kay ngi ma fi way ñu dem suma mag, or say ñu ngi am ataya fele ñu dem fofu. And instead of going there to learn something, to build yourself, now you are going to somewhere where I didn't even intend to go to. In the English culture, they call it going to shoot pigeon. To shoot pigeon, right? In my younger days, we used to have the catapult. We would spend the whole morning looking at these birds, pigeon, marabu bat, and all these kachokachos. Now, if I want to do that, that's my business. I can go, but I should not pull you out of your studies to go follow me. And you know, Ndaysan, we had colleagues back in the days then who would run from school every Thursday, primary school, to go to follow these tourists because there was a tour service operator called Columbus, wasting time. Now, that's another area. You know, we have to be wise how we use our time. I think I've made the case for the importance of time, right? Now we know time is important. And now we are not going to kill it, right? I have a youth organization, voluntary. We call it Sabally Leadership Academy, SLA. So I was giving lectures for the past 1 year. I intended to do 10 lectures for them to graduate. Others to come, they refused to graduate. Now I'm stuck with them. Shame on them, right? Anyway, I love them. They're part of my family. So occasionally we'll want to have a lecture and one of the girls, I'm sorry, most of the time it's girls, dema am ginte, dema am taka, duma muna nyo. And this really angers me. Because fine, this is part of our culture, this is part of our deen. You know, the ginte, the taka, fine, they're all part of it. What I tell them is, which ayah in the Quran says that you should spend the whole day in a ginte or a taka from subah to evening? Which ayah tells you? Not in my Quran. And I read that every month. So, if Mr. Jah has a ginte, fine, mentor, very nice man, you know, kind to everybody. Go to the gate for God's sake. Either go in the morning or in the evening. Maybe if you are Mr. Jah's brother from the same mother and father, definitely you need to be there to support him the whole day. But you from FEGAMSO camp, you have no business spending the whole day. In fact, you'll be distracting him because he'll have to attend to you for the whole day when other guests are coming. So we need to be wise on how we use our time. You want to watch movies? Fine, I'm not saying movies are haram. Go watch movies. But which ayah in the Quran says that you should watch a movie from Isha to Fajr? Come on, you are wasting your time if you are doing it that much. You know, I'm not an expert in time management, but I use my time well. I guess by now all of you know that I'm managing two leading national institutions. I am managing director, which is a job of its own, editor-in-chief, which is a job of its own, of the Daily Observer. So I manage and edit and publish the Daily Observer on a daily basis. I am managing director of the Gambia Radio and Television Service, and that's two institutions too. And people ask me, how do you do this? Because I manage my time well. I refuse to waste my time. When you come to a meeting to me, most of us say, my friend, can you get rid of all the preambles? Let's go straight to the point. And that's why we invented this phrase with a good genial friend, Sultan, and his team. We say, watu tiye. In Mandinka, it means time amut. Now, because Gambians, to be honest, we waste a lot of our time. You cannot come to me, you want me to do an advert in the Observer. Instead of saying that in 5 minutes, you want to tell me the history of your company, when you started, the problems you... I'm not interested in that. You want an advert for Observer, tell me the material you want, I'll tell you the price we negotiate, you go. I'm not going to sit down here and listen to you for the rest of the day, because I don't have the time. And after all, I have a family. They also deserve my time, and that's fard on me. So I have to give them that time. And that's why today I came with Latir and Khadija, because I'm hardly at home. When I leave in the morning, I get back at home at midnight sometimes. So to spend more time with them, I decided to come with them here. So they're with me here. We spend time in the car. They're here looking at me. We'll spend time in the car, go back home. I am making maximum use of my time of coming to this gathering and going back. Sometimes I bring them in my office. Because my work is important, but my time with them is also important. So we have to be wise and smart on how we use our time. And one of the best ways of making good use of your time is also to have plans, daily plans. You wake up in the morning or even before you go to bed at night, make a list of the important things that you want to do. Now, why am I saying important things? Because we have to prioritize. Not all things are of equal importance. Like sometimes, I know, like today for instance, I wanted to visit a friend, and that guy is important because whenever I visit him, I have more ideas for my work. I had about 3 people book appointments for today. I said, no, today is not possible. From here, I'm going to a meeting with a partner company that's supposed to partner with GRTS. In the evening, I'm supposed to go to Daily Observer and edit the paper for tomorrow. And I'm supposed to have time for my family. And I have 1,001 other things, but I prioritize. So today, I decided that coming here is more important for me than going to my friend or attending to the other appointments. Not that they are not important, but on a scale of preference, this is more important to me. Because here, I see that I'm investing my time and investing into you. And hopefully, by the grace of Allah, it will bear fruit as you will grow up to become responsible citizens and also be a source of inspiration to other people. So we have to prioritize. There are so many things to do in this world, in this time and now, that the need for prioritization could not have been more urgent. This is the age of Twitter and Facebook and Pinterest and which are the other ones? The girls, you should answer this question. You know them better than the boys. You have to prioritize. And when you are on those platforms, and those who pretend not to be on Facebook, we know you are there, you are changing your name, and taking another person's picture as your, or you take La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah picture, you make it your Facebook picture. We know you are there. So we are not saying don't be there, but you are spending time on Facebook. When you are spending that time, why don't you rather invest that time rather than spend it? How do you invest time? For me, Facebook is my biggest university. What I learned from Facebook, I didn't even learn in my master's degree program. But how? Because once I'm on Facebook, I'm on the news feed, I'm looking at who is posting something that can educate me, that can inspire me, that can guide me. What kind of postings are newsworthy so that I can assign my staff at Observer and GRTS to do stories? And that's why wherever I am, I insist that my staff have to be on social media. Because most of the interesting stories that I see you post something that FEGAMSO youth camp is going to Katong for an excursion. Straight, I forward it to my youth department at Observer GRTS, go follow them, do an interview. I hear that a member of your association wins Quran competition in Dubai. I inbox it straight to one of my journalists. Go and interview that person. I've done that several times. So I use my time in Facebook to invest, to learn, to grow, and to inspire. I use my time on Facebook to spread Quran. Every morning I do a Facebook post on the Quran. So no matter what you do, no matter where you are, you have to prioritize. You have to think of how to use your time well. I'm running short of time, and this is time management. If I go beyond this on time management, I would have mismanaged my time. What's the second part of this lecture? Self-esteem. What is self-esteem? Yes. What is self-esteem? Yeah, I know it's a very difficult subject to address, even for me. Self-esteem means having a feeling of respect for yourself and your abilities. Having a feeling of respect for yourself and your abilities. You know, Mr. Ja, I've seen something here that I've not seen in many youth gatherings. Participants taking notes, that's very important. Unfortunately or fortunately, the girls are taking more notes than boys. Self-esteem. It also connotes a sense of confidence and satisfaction in oneself. Confidence and satisfaction in oneself. Now, these are definitions I took from an expert magazine called Psychology Today. And just by way of contrast, I'm quoting from Psychology Today, a world-renowned magazine. Yes, spell it for her. I'm sure she's Kianka. She can't spell well. Where are you from? Kian. You see, didn't I get that right? You should congratulate me. I know them very well. Now, I'm quoting. It says, possessing little self-regard can lead people to become depressed If you don't have enough self-esteem, you can become what? Depressed. To fall short of their potential or to tolerate abusive situations and relationships. Okay, now, this is a very difficult subject to address. And I'm going to actually slow down my pace here so that I don't confuse you. Because there is a fine line between self-esteem, and arrogance and undue pride. And you know what Allah says about arrogance and undue pride in the Quran, huh? He loves it, right? He loves that. Where are you from? Who is the definition of arrogance in the Quran? Yes. Yes. Who? There is a person who's named in the Quran who is the definition of arrogance. It's Fir'aun. It is Fir'aun. Only to the extent that Iblis is not a human being. But he started everything. Now, listen, I'm still quoting. It says, too much self-love, on the other hand, results in an off-putting sense of entitlement and an inability to learn from failures. It can also be a sign of clinical narcissism. Now, that's a psychological term. Now, this magazine is saying that perhaps no other self-help topic has spawned so much advice and so many often conflicting theories as the concept of self-esteem. Now, this is very interesting. I am saying self-esteem is like believing in yourself, have confidence in yourself, which is a good thing. As from the plethora of books that I've read on this subject, one of the leading authorities in this is American Ralph Waldo Emerson. Yes, I read the non-Muslim authors also, and we should be open-minded enough to read these people. Because most of the time, when I really want to learn about Islam, I learn about Islam from non-Muslims, these Western philosophers. Because they've read our books. They've read the Quran, they've read the Hadith, they've read all of our great philosophers and taken their own theories and philosophies out of it. Now, what Ralph Waldo Emerson, who is not a non-Muslim, who I read religiously, by the way, he says self-confidence and self-trust is all based on faith. And what is faith? How do you say call faith in Islam, in Arabic? Iman. You cannot have true self-esteem, self-confidence, if you don't have iman. And why? Because in our theology, in our philosophy, the ultimate fact is, when you go to Surah Al-Hashr, when Allah describes himself, one of the most comprehensive is, Huwal awwalu wal, it's closed. Where do we exist in between these two extremes? Practically, we don't exist. And that's why we submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that self-esteem, that self-confidence, could only be authentic, in my opinion, you can disagree with me, if you submit to that creator subhanahu wa ta'ala who created you from nothing. And that self-esteem and that self-confidence should only be based on the dictates of the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Suratin, لَخَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمِ. And he stopped there, right? He didn't stop there. Where did he go? Okay, don't go there for now. But just to know that, he said he created us in the best of mold. I think that is enough a source for anybody to have that self-confidence and self-esteem. But there are rules and regulations to guide us. I'm not going to go into that. Maybe your sheikhs will get into those details later. If you don't follow those rules, then the ayah completed. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمِ. Then what's the other part? ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ السَّافِلِينَ. And we see those definitions here on earth. You see a human being, sometimes you think you are looking at an angel. But there are others you look at, you think you are seeing who? The devil himself. No, that's the fact. It's not difficult. Whatever Allah tells us in the Quran is manifest in the physical world. And that's why for some people the ayah is not only the verse of the Quran, it's also all these manifestations in the universe. So we are going to have self-esteem, self-confidence, but based on iman, based on the fact that he is al-awwal wal-akhir, wa-zahir wal-batin. He is the one and the only. And we are just creations of him, created to do what? And when he said that we decide to spend all our life in mosques, right? The work you do is part of your ibadat. The marriage you are attending is part of your ibadat. The FEGAMSO retreat you are attending is part of your ibadat. Going to school is part of your ibadat. Because he told our prophet what the first ayah he brought on the prophet was, I'll take you to hellfire, right? What did he tell him? Iqra. What are we doing here? Is there any better worship than what you are doing here? MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. Now I'm going to give you three keys to self-esteem. And this is a very difficult subject. You can hide under your veil and your cap and everything, but all of us from time to time, we are struggling with this issue. We don't feel valued enough. We don't feel important enough. And it can take us to extremes. And I believe, in fact, all these so-called nonsense jihadists, so-called jihadists, because they are not jihadists, who are taking Muslim lives and saying Allahu Akbar, is partly lack of self-esteem. Because if you value yourself as a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who brought us here to serve him, to follow the sunnah of who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was brought here as what? A rahmah. You would not go and kill even a kafir, much less a Muslim in a mosque on Friday. It's a lack of self-esteem. And what is a better key? What is a better key to the need to understand and appreciate ourselves as creations of Allah who are here to worship him and to spread the light and to spread goodness and beauty as per the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah in the Quran, the same Quran that it tells us, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمِ, he tells us what? وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. Won't you look at yourself? Now again, back to my philosophers, the Ralph Waldo Emersons, the Henry David Thoreaus, the James Allens. Now they tell you, look, don't go further. Don't try to discover the world. Discover the worlds within you, the human being. وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. If you were to follow that path alone, you'll spend your whole life and you will not be able to fully establish who you are. But what is important is that it is a journey. It's not a destination. It is our calling to know and understand ourselves, because if we know and understand ourselves, we will know who. Who will we know if we understand ourselves? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, you know, these people who study the teeth, they are called what? Dentists. Those who study the eye, they are called what? Opticians. What is their aim? What are they trying to achieve in their studies and their profession? What are they trying to study? They are studying to make it, the teeth, right? To create another tooth. They are studying to create another eye. They are studying to understand this. Understand just one part of your body. A person spends his whole life and he never exhausts that knowledge. One person studies the eye his whole life just to understand. That's why one of my favorite sheikhs, Sheikh Hamza Yusuf, Caucasian American, who understands Islam more than most of our sheikhs, he's a Muslim himself who came and studied here in West Africa. He says if you want to give a doctor trouble, even a cardiologist, the cardiologist will tell you the heart beats, right? Ask that cardiologist, why does the heart beat? Will he answer your question? وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. If you look at yourself, study yourself in all those dimensions, you will value yourself, you will have that self-esteem, and you will know that that self-esteem is not based on which tribe you belong to, or which family you are from, or how healthy is your bank account, or how good are your grades. You are who you are because Allah created you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah does not create junk. You are valuable, you should value yourself. And how do you value yourself? By following the Quran and the Sunnah. Because the Quran is the owner's manual. When you buy a new TV set, how do you operate it? You go to the owner's manual, right? But what do we do with our own lives, which is billions of times more valuable than the TV? For our own lives, we look at the proverbs of our grandfathers, and we look at family life education, and we look at Grace Anatomy, and we look at Weary to be able to run our own lives. That Quran is the owner's manual. If you understand yourself, you value that, you will value yourself. And your value and your level of self-esteem should not be determined by whether you are a Sarabuli or a Jahanka. Now I'm saying your value, that self-esteem, should not be based on your tribe or your bank account or your grades. You are a human being created by Allah. Allah does not create any junk. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانِ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمِ. You have value. You should have self-esteem. And that self-esteem includes not to walk out of that house with all your private parts barely showing out. That self-esteem includes to preserve yourself until you meet your rightful partner, not to throw yourself to boys and girls just because that is cool, because it is not cool and it will never be cool. Now Allah tells us in the same Quran, Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila li ta'arafu inna akramakum indallahi inna akramakum indallahi al-arab la inna akramakum indallahi al-suninka la inna akramakum indallahi atqakum wa inna khala laqulqul azim. When he was praising our prophet, khayra khalqillahi kullihi, and he's from the best lineage, he did not tell him that you are exalted because you are Quraysh. He didn't say that. Based on his habit, on his character, on his ethos. So you will have to understand these verses and live those verses, not just read them for the sake of reading. Understand them and live them and value yourself. That nobody is better than you because he's from a different tribe or a different race or even a different family. You are a human being, you have value, and if you want to develop your self-esteem, identify your strengths and talents. Allah has created all of us different. He has given all of us different missions in life. The fact that your friend is going to school of medicine doesn't mean you should not. Maybe you should go to the school of tailoring. So everybody has a gift that Allah has given you, and now you are going to develop your talents because that is part of your mission in this world. Whether you are a tailor, a farmer, or a trader, all our roles are valuable. Whether you are a jihadi guy in the field doing dawah, or you are a businessman, your roles are all important. Alima an sayakunu minkum marda wa akharuna yadribuna fil ardi yabtaghuna min fadlillah wa akharuna yuqatiluna fi sabilillah. What is Allah saying? Faqra'u ma tayassara min al-Qur'an. But the point I'm driving is Allah says he understands some of us are in jihad and some of us are in business. So is business important or not? It is. You don't have to be what other people are. You can be yourself and be an authentic Muslim with genuine self-esteem and self-respect. But you will have to identify your talents. And the talent is not important. Now you have to learn the skills and demonstrate it. About 15 years ago, I read a book that was talking about hidden talents. Hidden talents. What are hidden talents? They are talents that you have, but you may not be aware of. And at that point, I realized I had a hidden talent, and it was writing. Now, I have identified my talent, right? What did I do about it? I thought I was a good writer, honestly. Then the biggest names in writing here were Sherif Bojang, Baba Gale Jalo, Cherno Baba Jalo. And outside, I said, I'm a better writer than these people. But I didn't take a microphone and go and say that. I kept it in me and demonstrated it. You have to do something. You know why I love the Murids? I love their saying, Jif Jil. You know, you do something, you earn what you reap. وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى ثُمَّ يُجْزَاهُ الْجَزَاءَ الْأَوْفَى. You cannot have anything except that. You have to demonstrate that. So you have a talent, you got to go and walk out. Now they call me the Gambia Spen, right? I'm sure you heard about that. If you've not heard about my sub-request, you are either a Kiyanka or from Sarahule. But it took me 15 years to get there for somebody to call me that name. And I took that name, I accepted it because I have self-esteem. Now it's very difficult to have self-esteem in this country, you know. Just a little bit of self-confidence, they'll say you are proud and arrogant. But if you bow your head such that you cannot even pronounce the verses of the Quran right, they say he's good. You are supposed to have self-esteem, and so long as you don't break the laws of God and man, raise your head high and walk and do your things. Demonstrate your talents. Just know that in the beginning and the end, it's only la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim. And your humility is due to him, and not to people who don't want to see you shine. Because Allah gave you these talents to demonstrate them. So the talent is there, you have to what? Demonstrate it. And you cannot say that you are a good marathon runner, you know you have the skill and you want to go to Olympics tomorrow. It will not happen, has never happened. You will have to go through practice after practice, trial after trial, competition after competition before you reach that height. Did I say all of you should be marathon runners? It's just an example for those of you from Kia. I like to talk to them a lot. Now for self-esteem, there's one thing also that we need to understand. Most of the time, you're doing something well and people, ah, boy, you're the, you know, you are good at this, you know. Even to accept a compliment becomes a program. Ah, little dara boy, living, you try to, when you know you like it. When somebody gives you a compliment, just say thank you. Perhaps if you are as religious as the Sarahulis claim to be, you can say, mashallah. Now, that's the kind of humility that you need to employ. That no matter how loud the applause, no matter how loud the praise, know that la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. All the praise and glory belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if something body gives you a compliment, say thank you. Because these things are hard to get by. To be able to identify that talent, to develop it, to demonstrate it, and to get recognized for it, it takes time. So when somebody says thank you, just accept it. Somebody says, congratulations, just say thank you. So we are going to be human beings that know we are servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brought here to do what? To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونِ. Allah said he did not create us for anything but to worship him. But even to worship him properly, we will need that self-esteem and that self-confidence. Because if you don't have it, even if you are asked to be an imam, you will not. Because you don't have that self-confidence. You need to develop that. Are you going to develop that to be proud and arrogant? No. You are going to develop that because it's a tool that you need to worship Allah properly. To be out there, to do your ibadat, to do your work, to excel in your talents, but in the niyyah of worship Allah and serve humanity in the greatest possible good for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On that note, I want to thank you very much for inviting me here. I have a very busy schedule, as I said, but when I was told that the Gambian Muslim students in an Islamic camp have invited me, I think this is about the greatest honor I've ever received. Because I think this is very important, that we identify ourselves as Muslims. Does that mean we have to treat ourselves to depression for the rest of our lives? No. Our religion is a very beautiful, very enjoyable religion, and we should enjoy it. Now I clapped here, I think something happened, I clapped and somebody was telling me not to clap. Which ayah of the Quran said it's haram to clap? Which ayah of the Quran said it? Now I want to, who read the Quran here? Who read the Quran here at the beginning? MashaAllah, what's your name? Lamin? Sisi, where are you from? Huh? What did he say? No. You are not from Badibu. You know why I'm saying that? When a Badibu guy is saying I'm from Badibu, how does he talk? Aha! Maybe you have come Kianka relations. And that was a beautiful, beautiful rendition of the Quran that actually literally brought me to tears. From Surah Nisa, right? Tawbah. Beautiful, beautiful rendition. And next time, go to Surah Maryam or something, man. Make me happy. But that's beautiful. That's real. I want to congratulate you for excellent recitation. I want to congratulate you all for being part of this great movement. I want to pray for Allah to bless this movement so that it grows bigger and better, and for Allah to bless you in your lives, and for Allah to bless your time, to put barakah in your time. Now, this is very important. To put barakah in your time. You know, Numar Ali Khan is one of my favorite preachers that I follow. He says, when you wake up on time and pray Fajr on time, Allah puts barakah in your time. I've not done the analysis, but I believe that. I don't care if you believe it or not. I believe it. Wallahi. Because I found out. Look, I do a lot with my life. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. To run two leading national institutions and run a family, it's next to impossible. But I find out that I get that barakah. I get to do more with my time when I'm doing the most zikr. It's my personal experience. So you want time management, you want to use your time well, try to do as much zikr as possible. Now, does that mean you have to confine yourself in the mosque and do zikr and the angels will go and do your work at the office? No. Sometimes the occasional subhanallah, bihamdi subhanallah al-azim, in between a meeting, during a meeting, at a football match. Sometimes I do most of my zikr at those times. At occasions where people have no business talking about, like in a workshop, launching some polio thing, I do my zikr. I do my zikr at those points. It's very important. As I said, I have no empirical proof for this, but it works for me. You want time management, you want your time to be useful to you, try to do zikr as much as possible. And I remember on one occasion that I was sitting there, this is many years ago, mashallah, Allah has given me that gift, that I would sit down anywhere and do my zikr. One photographer, it's called Mr. Mar, he noticed it. He came to me, he said, what you are doing is very important. I said, why? He said, you know, in these kind of occasions, when most people are not even thinking about what, for you to do zikr is very important. So don't restrict your zikr only in the masjid or the halaqa or the FEGAMSO camp. Wherever you are, try to remember Allah. Try to remember Allah. And as my Sheikh Hamza Yusuf would say again, he said, you know what? I believe our existence here is zikr. It's zikr. Because whether you're doing salah or tilawat or you're doing community service, if you have the right niyyah, it's zikr. You understand? So he says, any time that you spend in this world that you are doing zikr, you are not doing zikr, is waste of time. And I believe him. I believe that. So wherever you are, try to remember God. Now, it doesn't have to be your mouth shouting out like a Sarahuli Imam. You can just sit down and look at those leaves and say, MashaAllah. Just if you look at that tree and remember God, that is zikr. Look, I was in China recently. The Great Wall of China, I went through this magnificent, one of the greatest wonders of the world ever. And I found it so overwhelming. I said, SubhanAllah, I was with Abu Bakr Dawa, Mr. Iqra. And I said, you know what, doesn't this remind you of some verse of the Quran? And guess what surah he took me to? Surah Najm. لَقَدْ رَأَى مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى. What is that? What is that ayah related to? Al Isra wal Mi'raj. He said, when the prophet went up, he saw the great signs of Allah. Now, I'm sure in your mind you say, SubhanAllah, he's comparing himself to the prophet. I know I'm not a prophet. I'm the worst sinner here. But I was up and I remembered Allah. And Allah addressed that Quran to Muhammad alayhi salam, just as he addressed to it to me. Because in the Quran, it's a personalized email. It's talking to each of us. So at those moments, you go to that fantastic excursion, that waterfall, let it remind you of Allah, let it be zikr. And you realize that barakah in your time. I want to conclude here. I want to thank you for your kind attention. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
My question is, you talk about self-esteem. I want you to differentiate or to tell me if they are the same. That is self-esteem and assertiveness. To be assertive.
Assertiveness, how many of you do some geometry? Assertiveness would be a subset of self-esteem. Because you cannot be assertive if you don't have self-esteem. Because if you are assertive, that means you believe in what you are saying. And you cannot believe in what you are saying if you don't believe in yourself. So it's a subset, it's part of it. But self-esteem is a wider concept.
I want to ask, who was your mentor with regards to time management?
Well, I can't say for sure that I had a mentor in terms of time management. Because, to be honest, I've been in youth work. My first work in this country was a youth worker in 97. I was responsible for youth and sports matters in the whole of Western Division. But some of these concepts you guys are dealing with here, I'm just seeing them in the youth gathering for the first time. Most of the time we just used to go to these programs, and most of the time we are thinking about empty concepts, like trying to change the world when we don't even think about our own lives. But I have several role models, Unfortunately, I'm sure you'll do the takfir on me, but most of my role models back then were non-Muslims. Albert Einstein, Isaac Newton, Steve Jobs, Benjamin Franklin. So my concept of time management, really, I learned it from Benjamin Franklin. He's one of the founding fathers of America. And it's from him that I quoted this thing, that if you would value your life, then take care of time, because that's the stuff that life is made of. But if you have a role model in time and you think of that light, our slogan is what would be time how much?
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Your name?
My name is Lamin KCC. And thank you so much for the lecture. I've benefited a lot. And the question that I want to ask is, I've seen a lot of people who are in their position, but it's hardly you see them living beside Fatiha correctly. So I'm amazed that you are someone who, when it comes to worldly matters, you learn a lot, and then you also learn the Quran, and then you're putting it into practice. I am young, but I am lucky to teach so many people. Some of them are not ministers, but they're working in the government. But sometimes, you know, I feel ashamed that a Muslim who has been in this dunya for 40 or 50 years, even Fatiha, it is composed in Salah. To read it, you find it very difficult, but I'm amazed. You're quoting passages in Surah Al-Imran, in Baqarah, in Maryam. MashaAllah, I am so amazed. I think if all those are working in the government, if they are like you, I'm sure we'll have a successful, you know, Gandhi, inshallah. I'm so proud of you. Yeah. How are you able to do this, MashaAllah?
Thank you for the compliments. Now, there's a lesson here in terms of self-esteem. I'm not saying, no, that's nothing, that's something, huh? You know, English student, I have all these verses. I know them, I'm very proud of it, so thank you. Only that I say, MashaAllahu, la quwwata, Subhanaka, from Surah Baqarah. What happened between the angels and Allah? Subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana. You have to say that. I'm still trying to re-emphasize this point of submission and giving due credit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I know many people see me as very confident. Some people even think I'm proud. I don't care what they say about me. I will not bow down to anybody because of your opinion of me. But it's important to me, and it should be important to you, that when the clap, when the applause, when the praise is highest, that you submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why I say, subhanak, la ilmana illa ma 'allamtana. I mean, I've gone to school with thousands of young people, and there are not many of them who are this verse in the Quran as me. Is that because only guy Sunday never say, or because I belong to a certain family? No, this is the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then back again, وَأَنْلَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَحَلْ مَا مُذَّكِرِ. He gave us a challenge. He said what? He's going to make the Quran difficult to learn, right? That's what he said. Huh? What did he say? He said he made it easy. And then what did he add? He's challenging us. Who of you is willing to learn? I'll tell you the story briefly. This is actually an interesting story that maybe not this year, I don't have time. Next year, I'll go and do a lecture. I realized early on that Allah has given me some intellect. MashaAllah. I thank Allah for it. Even though my mother gave me a lot of... Who of you can speak Mandinka? Ali Hakim Diyaran Masolwan. They are laughing. They all drank it. It's not from that. It's from Allah. I think Allah gave me some predisposition for intelligence, and particularly for languages. So, of course, we all did the Dara. I did the Karanta. You know Dara Karanta, Royal? Yes, at least I can relate with some ghetto youths here. Karanta, we did that. That's the local Mandinka one. You go at night, you put fire, and you start. Gabaya, I think, in the Karam, right? We did Wolundi, Umajati, Lumajati, you know, the way they say it back in Kiang. We did all of that. We did Dara. You know, primary school, I'm sure it's better now. Those times our ustaz will come and tell you, Musa and Firaun. Every day, the lesson is Musa and Firaun. And there's this other one called, it's Ewaja, right? The tall guy.
He would tell us all these stories. And after 12 years of primary and secondary education, if you see Surah Fatiha written, you will not recognize it. He said, try it.
So by the time I finished St. Peter's, I went to Dalia High School, 6th form. 6th form is the most difficult education I've ever done. 10 times more difficult than the master's degree. So we went through that, and I just, mashallah. I said that, look, the effort I'm doing in this way, I was a top student, mind you, 94, I was the best student at Dalia High School, A-levels, with my friend Abdullah Bagi from, I mean, now was civil aviation.
I said, all this stuff what I'm doing on this Yangi Tubab Karamo. I believe if I did 10% of that effort in the Quran, I would excel. MashaAllah, this was the turning moment in my life. Gabi High, 93, 94. Now, when we finished, I had a good friend. Oh, I should have brought him here. When is your seminar closing? I cannot promise, but I'll try to bring him here. This guy, I have many friends, but this guy is dear to my heart. He's Ibn Dur. He was a very good friend of Tafsir Gay, the Imam of Banjul, who I have a lot of regard for. I don't care what anybody thinks about him. He's one of the smartest Gambians alive. Not just smart in terms of intelligence, wit is amazing. So this guy was a friend of Tafsir Gay, and Tafsir Gay used to have daras in Banjul. First days he go learn the Quran, Fridays he just goes dawah. I was living in Banjul then, Boxbar Road. So every first day we would go there, just an hour. We do the Quran. Every Friday we go in Dost Dawa. Around 94, I was living with my sister, who was a police officer, police line. She moved to Prikam. I moved with her, but I was so attached to the program. I used to pay fares. Can you imagine a poor school leaver then? I used to pay fares to come to Bangui. And I just saw that he was a bit impressed. He said, you know what? He had one of these senior ustas, this ustas saw. He asked him to teach me the phonics, so that when I'm home, I can teach myself. So I did the phonics, whatever you call it. So I did that. But this friend of mine, he will do, may Allah increase his life and bless his life and his family. He thought I had a very strong memory. So he used to push me towards reading the Quran and studying the Quran. That is a fantastic guy. Every time we go into his house, the Quran is on 24/7. Even when we were chatting, the Quran is on, don't do a fatwa on me, we used to do it, it was beneficial. And one of the favorite surahs there was Ali Imran and Furqan, one of the most beautiful surahs in the entire Quran. But Ibu insisted that I have my own house and be praying the Quran because he believes that I can memorize the Quran. So I took the challenge. Then we started university extension program in 1995. I was doing a degree in mathematics, believe it or not. Again time management, again self-esteem. Ibn Dur was not my friend. He was at St. Augustine's 6th form. I was in Gambia High 6th form with my friend Omar Mbo. He was a friend of Omar Mbo and they are from Half-Life. So through Omar, University of the Gambia. But every time we want to study the Quran, we in fact hired an ustaz. He's called Sajo, somewhere in London corner. We used to go there every week, full-time university student, doing a degree in mathematics. At the same time, I was going to Alliance Francaise to study French. Time management. I had the same time with every student. But I added those Arabic classes, those French classes, and I was a student leader at the same time. Time management, work it, use it, invest it. So we used to do that, and when I got more fame with the phonics, I started reading the Quran. Sometimes I'd play the team. My favorite surahs were Nisa, Furqan, Ali Imran, and Maryam. Beautiful. So I started to listen to the Quran, practically teaching myself and reading. And I bought a Walkman, poor as I was. I bought a Walkman with this, it was Muhammad and Muhammad. And you know when he's reading this, he will cry until a friend of mine, a very British man, he's a Giyaka. He said, in reality, come with me, Muhammad will be a killer. That's not true. So I used to listen to this Muhammad over and over, who came as one of the greatest lessons in the Quran. I would pray that in when I'm walking in the car, in the car, the Quran is in my head. When I'm in the car, it's in my head.
Self-esteem and confidence, we are expressing them, which will also help us to develop ourselves and also contribute to the development of the race.
You know, I think I've addressed this question, but I will address it again because it's important. I can't talk about this enough. Because it's very difficult to have that self-esteem and self-confidence in our society. This is sad. It's really sad. You know, I'm a motivational speaker and author. I've written 10 books. and all is geared towards inspiring young people and guiding them. And I know you cannot be successful at any level without having self-confidence and self-esteem. I believe that Barack Obama became who he is because of self-confidence, nothing else. Any other thing is an add-on. But this is a society where, even where you, when you wear nice clothes, they say they're far bluff. So the point is for you to reflect on yourself as a creation of Allah, as a Muslim, which is a beautiful religion, not a religion that's supposed to depress you. That in one of these, Islam, and that dress you wear affects your self-confidence, whether you know it or not. If I were wearing a t-shirt and a jeans here, I would have been speaking on a different tone than now. You understand? Gambia is definitely different territory. You know that for some people, even my friend Sultan was saying, some people say that I'm proud. I don't care what they say about me. I know that I have more respect for my white man than most of them have for their own parents. But you have to understand that you don't owe anybody an obligation. Pula fail in school, therefore Nadara cannot dictate your life. Now you know you are a Muslim. So long as you are within the confines of the Quran and Sunnah, nothing is wrong. Do what you want to do. Bulton, Ken Bulton, Bulton, Nara, but other than that, you think this is good, do it. If they see you excelling a little bit, they start throwing remarks at you. Recently I had a remark about a young man who is my mentor, mentee, who is doing very well. A colleague of that person, who I had a lot of respect for, a Muslim for that matter, and that's why I respect her most, he said that guy is very selfish. You know, he even said certain things that I won't want to mention here, just because the guy is excelling. So again, you need to do a little bit of that introspection, value yourself, not on the path of arrogance, but on the fact that Allah has made you and Allah doesn't take junk. You are a valuable human being. Value yourself, respect other people. Beyond that, you don't owe anybody an apology. Go get it.